All right, 7 p.m. I'll call the select board meeting.
6 p.m.
Oh, 6 p.m., excuse me. What the hell is that? Somewhere. 6 p.m. The select board meeting of Conway together, the order now, and the first thing on our agenda is we're being filmed by FCAT, and Dan's doing the filming for us. Doing a great job of it. First item on the agenda is to approve the minutes of Monday, June 19th.
Yep.
Approve
them. I would second that.
Make a motion. You second?
Yep.
All in favor?
Aye.
That's good. Thank you. Approved. Next thing is our warrants. First thing is a vendor warrant for $151,991.70. Make a motion. We approve it?
I second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next one is a vendor warrant for 2018 for $225,974.69. Make a motion to approve.
So that's a different number than I have here, or is that the total?
Do we have a typo?
My printed copy as opposed to the...
Oh. Yeah, yeah. We didn't have that at the time you printed it out.
I see. Okay. Great.
We have that number now.
Now I got that number. So again, sure. Yes, I would second that.
I'll second. And that is approved. Next time is a payroll warrant for $123,103.98. Make a motion. We approve.
So move.
Second it.
Aye.
In favor. We both agree. No problem. And the last one is a payroll deduction warrant for $31,433.12. And make a motion that we approve it.
I'd second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Those are all approved. Okay, next item on the agenda is a meetings attended by the select board. Do you have any this week?
The quarterly meeting got postponed, so no, I don't. Okay. I mean, other than we all had a busy time at the wonderful 250th.
Okay.
So.
Okay. All right, next thing is citizens' concern. Malcolm Cross has a citizen of concern for us.
Yep, two of them. Lisa will need a copy of that. When you're done.
And a copy now.
Oh, good, thank you.
You want to explain this for us, Malcolm?
My concern is, I don't know who.
Well, can you explain the whole thing, because they were on camera?
Well, where do I start? There's two historic wagons that were made in Conway. One is the Holcomb wagon, which we had in the parade, and the other one's a Hemingway wagon, which was built down Hickory Ridge. At the beginning of the 250th committee meetings, I'll back up. My brother had given those wagons, I assume, to the Historical Society. So at the beginning of our meetings, some 6 or 7 years ago, he agreed to take the ownership of those wagons away from the Historical Commission and give them to the 250th Committee so we could work on them and get them ready for the parade. And as this letter says, that after the parade, they go back to, I believe it says, the town of Conway. Now, I've contacted the Historical Society, and they don't seem to want to have any part of it, mainly because they don't have any storage, any dry storage. And I have one of the wagons down to Christine Conklin. The other one's on my trailer. And it ain't going to stay there for very long. My agreement with Christine Conklin was to... She would store them until after the parade. I haven't been able to contact her since. I've asked her to extend my period of time to put them there, and I don't know what's going to take place. I asked Eddie Zajac if we could store them in his barn, and he said no, he was full. Now, I have two other places I haven't contacted yet. One is Suki, above me, and the other one's McCoy's, which is Andy Hart's old barn. And what we need is dry storage that costs nothing. I don't think the town of Conway wants to pay for storage. I have contacted David Lee, which is Dean Lee's son, and he hasn't indicated to me that there's room there or that he will do it for nothing. I understand he was in town this last weekend. I wish I had known that. I would love to have the opportunity to talk to him. But I never was informed of that, so I couldn't do it. The other concern I have is the fourth wheel for the other wagon could run as much as $600. I've had the three wheels already repaired. I have new shafts for it. And I don't know how to go about getting payment for the other wheel, other than maybe if the select board would okay it, I think there's enough money left in my parade budget to pay for a wheel. But I don't want to go off in the deep end and go to Pennsylvania and buy a $600 wheel or less out of my own pocket.
So that's the Hemingway wagon?
That's for the Hemingway wagon, yeah. Which was built down in. And the other wagon that we used is now not a one-horse wagon. It can be used as such because I got new shafts. But through the generosity of Barry Roberts, he found a pole that would fit it. So he had a team of halflingers, which are a small team. That's why there was two horses pulling that wagon. Mm-hmm. So, and it's one of the few things that we still have that was made in Conway, but we can't exhibit it. We can't even store it. We all know, I mean, I'm preaching to the choir when I say this, we all know we need storage. And hopefully if I can get some dry storage for the next 3 or 4 years, whether I see it or not, there'll be storage whenever the new garage is built. I hope there's room enough to store some of these big artifacts. It's a shame to let that stuff get away from us. People talk about insurance. What are you going to do for insurance? Well, my idea of insurance on things like that, if they burn up, what are you going to do with the money? You can't build another one.
Yeah.
So I don't say carry a lot of insurance on it. But, so I guess I need some answers. If anybody knows of any dry storage, help me. And
this letter, the end says that Robert is asking the trustees of Conway Historical Society to transfer ownership to the 250th committee.
Right, which they did.
If the town's going to take that over, we'll probably need a letter from the Historical Society stating that's what took place. Well, even though we have this from your brother Robert.
I have talked to Peter Engelman, and he said he can't find anywhere where this letter was ever generated. But believe me, it was. It's a shame that Robert didn't get a chance to sign it. And there's no date on it. But I'm sure if we went out here where all the minutes of the meetings of the 250th committee, and I probably was premature coming, but I hadn't done it. And look up in those records, you'll see why that was discussed when Dave Barton was on that committee.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That was probably, you think it was voted then?
It was voted then to do this.
They'll have the record of it then.
So.
Before we can take ownership of these, we'd have to have that from the.
So this is more of a heads up than anything, so you aren't being.
The unfortunate thing is like you just said, if the town takes ownership, what are we going to do?
Well, that's it.
So one of the wagons is now in Christine Conklin's barn?
Right.
So with three and where's the other one?
The other one's on my trailer in my yard.
Oh, it's on your trailer, right.
I stored it all last winter because Bud Blair said he and Kim were going to fill the body, it wasn't going to cost me a nickel. Well, lo and behold, my youngest son lives outside of Nashville, Tennessee. He came up in April and did some of it. And 3 days before the parade, he came up and finished it. So, there it is.
Well, I guess what we'll say is, I would think, you know, you got any discussion about it, that we probably should look into this with the Historical Commission. We got to make sure that everything is done legally.
I understand that.
I think if Malcolm has money left to buy a fourth wheel.
Well, I'm sure there's money. I had a $20,000 budget for the
period. Yeah.
$6,000 was pulled out when I wasn't here, which is another sour note. But given to the school, the grammar school, to build 6 floats. Well, they built 1 float. And I don't think it was $6,000 that it cost them for that float.
I do know that the 250th budget as it stands is all used up. So
no,
there is nothing left in the funds for the 250th anniversary.
Well, then I've been kept out of the loop then.
I want to mention we seem to be using
a couple of organizations. I'm a little unclear. This is to the Conway Historical Society.
Right.
That is a private organization.
Yeah.
The Conway Historical Commission is part of the town of Conway.
Had nothing to do with it.
So we've been using both of those terms during this discussion. I just want to clarify that it is the Historical Society that had ownership.
Yep.
Okay.
I question your statement as to the 250th budget is used up.
I just heard it from the accountant today.
Well, all the invoices aren't in yet.
Well, then they're going to... Actually, they have already gone over budget, and she's getting money from the donations account to apply to the bills that were spent.
I don't know how it could be used up. I had a budget of $20,000. $6,000 went to the school, and the people that are in the parade, I think it totaled like $6,500. So where had the rest of it go?
Well, it has...
You'll find that in the warrants that were just signed.
I think you...
They all haven't been turned
in. Have they taken the... And I'm like guessing this. Have they taken the money that was donated to the 250th committee and any money they've earned? Was that put in a totally separate account from the account that the town funded?
Yes. And it yes. And we have had to use that in order to pay the current bills.
Well, I understand.
Or some of it.
I understand.
There is more money left in the donations account.
Yes, yes. And the money was divided into two separate accounts, Malcolm.
They told me it wasn't.
Well, evidently the town treasurer did that.
So if it was divided into two different accounts, why did the selectmen have to okay the invoices? Why couldn't those invoices have been attached to the donations account? Because that wasn't raised through taxation.
No, but the select board still has to approve all expenses.
Why?
Because they are the chief executive officer.
I mean, if somebody gave me $10,000 and I had a show with it, okay, I've got to vote the selectman to get payment out of it? I don't think so. I think that's a... I will look into that because I can't believe that my $20,000 budget is totally used up.
Well, I wouldn't necessarily say your $20,000 budget is used up. The budget of the 250th anniversary celebration committee is used up.
That original,
so that,
what was that, $40,000?
$60,000. Yeah. There's invoices of $1,800 got to be paid yet.
That will have to come out of the donations account.
Okay. Well, before I get any madder than I am right now.
Well, I think I would think if your committee claims they haven't gone out of money yet, it's probably because of the combination of the two accounts.
I'll talk to her.
We have to use the town's account up first, which they did, and Tom says now that's at zero, and now they're starting to use it off this other account, which is still legitimate to do.
As long as it wasn't siphoned off somewhere else.
No, of course not. No.
Yeah. So. Well, we wouldn't pay anything for that we didn't have receipts for.
How long will Christina allow us to store that wagon in her barn?
I've been trying to make contact with her.
Yeah.
And I haven't been able. She's been very gracious to let it be there as long as I have.
Absolutely.
And I'd like to have the one that is usable to be somewhere where it's accessible, because I think some of them like to have it in their parade. And when I used it 50 years ago, it was in this parade and I was driving it. It was in Shelvin's parade. I was driving it, and I was in Sunderland's parade, and I was driving it. And if those towns want to have it, well, it's fine. And let them foot the bill.
So the only place I know that we could store it is in the sheep barn.
No, it came out of there because of dirt floor. It's a horrible place to store it.
So do we have anywhere else we could store anything? I mean, that...
No.
So we're... Dependent upon somebody stepping forward and saying,
right,
so, I have dry space.
Shouldn't you know of anybody or hear of anybody.
That's right.
All right, we'll look into this and do the society. And
Tom, you've got my career out here. I certainly will look into it pretty deeply. Thank you all.
Thank you, Malcolm. Okay, next item is old business. Do we have any old business, Tom?
Not that I know of.
Okay. Okay, then we'll move on to new business. Appointments. The junior firefighters, for a second.
Yeah, we've talked about that.
We'll get that straightened out. Reappoint Gary Fenn to the Zoning Board of Appeals. Is that in here, Tom?
Yes.
Is an appointment letter there?
Or a form, appointment form.
Okay.
Appointment form.
That's like, and there's Gary Fenn, that is.
Oh, yes, those, the stipend forms aren't, they've already been approved. They just need one more.
Which we did.
My piece, and I think John needs to sign one, and someone else.
Yeah, John signed one, and I signed one. I signed both of them, and Bob signed.
Well, it's one is for
John, and one's for Bob.
So you signed both of them.
I signed both of them, and it should be all set.
Yeah. Okay. That's beautiful. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
All right, so let's get back to Gary Fenton. We need to reappoint Gary Fenton to the Zoning Board of Appeals for a term ending June 30th, 2020. That's a mouthful.
Yes. The Select Board appointed him to use up the current term back in August. And he was supposed to be on the list to be reappointed.
Okay, do we want John being the chairman to sign these, probably? We can just prove them tonight. John can sign them.
What he actually recused himself last time because he's on the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Okay, right.
So I think it'll
I'll
be
make
fine.
A motion that I sign it or you sign it. And
sure.
For Gary Fenn?
Second.
Favor?
Aye.
Sure is a good second.
But. Yeah.
We can both sign it. How's that?
Yeah, why don't we?
Come on, get out of there.
Who's the other one?
Kronaki. And the next one is to appoint Carl Nelke to the Wastewater Committee for a term ending June 30th, 2018. I'll make a motion to approve it.
I'd second it.
In favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next item is sign a contract with the state for assessor's software conversion from CAMA to IS World. IS World.
Yes.
Do you have any information on that, Lee?
I do. The CAMA program that we have had for the last 15 years is one that we found when we had to change over to a different program at that time. It was sponsored by the Department of Revenue, and it's been a fantastic program. About 20% of the towns in the state have been using it. However, with state budget rearrangements, something that's used by only 20% of the towns is no longer being supported. And so our program is being phased out. However, the state has not abandoned us. They have led the initiative in finding a very good replacement program and negotiating a contract for the towns involved with this Tyler Technologies, mm-hmm. which writes the IAS World program. And they also are helping with some of the conversion costs. And now in the past, we've paid about $1,800 a year for everything, for the program, the use of the program, for all upgrades and any support time, which has been fantastic.
That was done by the state.
Yes, we've saved tens of thousands over doing it outside through a regular commercial vendor and had a great program. The cost of this is going to go up a little bit, but not as much as going to one of the standard outside vendors. The program, been through two tutorials of it, and it appears to be very, very good, very responsive to our needs. And they will also have readily available backup They are going to be in touch with the Department of Revenue so that they can predict upgrades or new reporting requirements that the DOR is going to ask of every town. So we decided that we would prefer to go with Tyler Technologies and IAS World rather than to step out into the great unknown, so to speak. Not the great unknown, but to step out and go independently with another vendor.
So there's still many towns using this?
There will be, yes. Yes, more than 40 so far have signed up to use this. The conversion will take place over the next couple of years. We'll be running the two programs simultaneously for at least 1 year in order to have plenty of time to double-check each and every detail to make sure that it's converted over correctly and is working properly. It already has all of the state's required reports, annual reports built into it, which is very nice. They will have you municipality training. We probably will not actually see any of it in-house until middle of 2018, so another year from now. But in the meantime, our state program is being maintained by the state until such time as this is in place. Then they will pay for the conversion costs, and we will have to pay for the time of our own personnel doing the conversion, and we already put in some money for that into this year's warrants. So we already have $2,500 tucked away toward that.
Right.
Yep. So what this is the town's enrollment contract that the town intends to enroll in the Tyler Technologies IAS World subscription as a service program through MassIT, which is the state office that's been set up to handle this conversion, MassIT. This outlines what is included with the program, the different modules, we might say, for the program itself, you know, building permit import interface. Yes, conversion scripting, changing over our photographs that are in each individual file, changing over the notes that are in each individual file so that they carry over well, the drawings, that all that type of thing.
How many years of data must we
have 15 years. We have more than that, but we have 15 years in this program, and I believe it will all be able to convert so that it will all still be accessible.
Yeah.
We will not destroy the old data in any way. We still keep it, and we are allowed to keep an existing license of the old program, the existing program, for as long as we want. It simply will no longer be supported by the state in any way. But that way we would still be able to access it through the current program if we needed to. But it's a double checking. It's a safety measure. And it will also all be backed up independently and saved on disk in the vault, too. Yeah. So, questions?
Yeah, I got two.
Okay.
You want us to sign the contract now?
Mm-hmm.
Do we have to pay for this first year, even though we're not going to be using the system?
No.
That's just to get the ball rolling by signing the contract.
That's right.
And you're... So you're not looking for any, you don't have to cough up any money the first year?
We do not.
Okay.
We are not going to have to cough up any money until 2020.
Okay. And how much more is it than last year's?
The 2020 figure, the figure that's already been negotiated for fiscal 2020 through 22 is $37.55 a year.
That's
which
quite
is
a bit
double.
More. Double.
It's about double. But going to one of the other vendors is up in the $5,000 to $10,000 a year league.
And is that what
so that's
most
part
of the
our
other
consideration.
Towns? I mean, we have 330 towns or something. You
some
know.
Towns have their own independent programs.
Sure. Uh-huh.
You know, the larger cities may. There are a number of programs that are approved by the Department of Revenue. And depending upon the skills and abilities that are in-house, if a town has its own IT, a city has its own IT department, they may well pick up one of the more comprehensive ones that have program modules that deal much more extensively with regression analysis, things that we don't need.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're paying for those. But they have the larger budget on which to do it.
Right. So your assessors have looked into this?
Yes. I've also worked with a couple of other programs.
Played with it a little bit to make sure it's user-friendly for you?
Yes, I went to Pittsfield.
Good.
And they've had it, they've worked with Tyler Technologies for several years now. And so I had an afternoon session in their office, hands-on.
Mm-hmm.
And also there were two online webinars where we got to play with it hands-on. And they encouraged us to work with it afterward and call in with any questions, whatever. They've been very responsive.
Yep. And my last question is, has our town council looked at this contract yet?
No.
So we need to
This is a state contract.
This is a state contract. It's been provided by the state for the town. It's been prepared by
the
state.
You're saying the town council doesn't need to look at that?
No, if it's okay with the state, it'll be okay with the town council.
Yeah. Yep.
No, I don't know. Because all the contracts we own by our council first.
Yeah.
Not the state contracts.
Yeah.
We have another one of those coming up. Mm. No, we have the...
So you the Board of Assessors recommend that we approve this?
The Board of Assessors does, but first off, there are two permissions that are asked of you. One is that the town of Conway agrees that Kathy Marks, or the Mass IT program manager, whoever that might be, or her designee, may work collaboratively with the town staff to manage the project and ensure project success. In other words, this is giving her permission to see our data. There's nothing in the valuation data that is not public record.
Mm-hmm.
There is no personal financial information. There is nothing like that that goes on to personal exemption applications. There's absolutely nothing there that is not public record. But we still are officially giving her office permission to do that. And for as long as the town of Conway is a current customer of Tyler's IS World, pursuant to this contract, the town agrees that Mass IT and the Department of Local Services Administrators, Department of Revenue, Local Services Agency, shall have administrative access to the town of Conway data through this program. Now, the Department of Revenue has access by law, although they rarely exercise it.
Right, right.
You know, if they come in for a revaluation, mm-hmm. usually they ask us for data, and we provide it, but legally they do have access. I've never known them to come in and sit down and pull something out without, including reporting functionality and data extraction across all participating communities, as it may be from time to time, be updated and reconfigured. So, those are the two permissions that are requested. And then we have a signature page that they will sign, that Tyler will sign, and that the town of Conway signs. And once the town of Conway, the Board of Selectmen, has signed on our behalf, I'll make copies for us to save here in-house until we get back the finally executed copies.
Any questions, Mark?
If you like it, we like it.
We hate to have to change.
Yes.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we approve the IAS World contract that the assessors recommended. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so I'll write in yes under those two permissions.
Yeah.
If you'll both initial those,
okay.
I'd appreciate that. So there are the two right in that one.
Do you want permission over here?
No, just sign by the yeses or...
Okay.
Yeah. And then your signature's in the third column here.
Okay.
Where is he? Where? Is John going to be signing this too? Probably. Do you need all three signatures?
Need two out of three, I believe, anyway. Yeah.
So you get this back, or you
can... I'll take it back, and they'll make copies right now,
okay.
And
then
leave an interim copy with you until we get the final back. They want all the communities to have signed by the end of July, and that way they can proceed with their contract structure with Tyler.
Great.
So, thank you.
Thank you, Lee. Appreciate that very much.
I'm glad you guys are on this.
Well, it's going to be a lot easier than it was last time we changed programs, that's for sure.
15 years ago?
Uh-huh. Yeah. So, very good.
So you are back in full swing, I guess, I understand?
I believe so, yes.
That's wonderful.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm glad you got better. Thank you.
Yes. I appreciate that. I appreciate using some of my vacation time and so forth as needed.
Oh.
Yep.
Not can happen to anybody.
See
thank you.
See you.
Okay. Next item is signed renewal agreement for the regional for Franklin County Council of Governments Cooperative Inspection Service.
This is our usual agreement with them for.
Made this. What's today's date? The 26th.
Building, gas, plumbing, electric.
26th day of July. 17.
And there are two copies of that.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve this contract for another year.
I'd second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'm not sure if that's right. I'm going to let you sign it too.
Okay.
Date?
26.
6/26.
What did I put? July? Yeah, okay. I'm mushing myself.
Not quite yet.
It's almost over, guys. Okay. 6/26. Too much paper to get out of here. Next item is to sign a rental agreement with Greg Rose for the use of the sheep barn for another year. This is the usual lease that we've always had. It has nothing changed on it, so I'll make a motion to approve it.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Even if we can't store Malcolm's wagon there.
We can do the letter and then have the capital improvements meeting with the capital improvements committee.
Okay. Next item is to do a letter of appreciation to Heidi Flanders and the 250th anniversary committee. Want me to read the letter, Tom?
Sure, if you like.
Dear Heidi, it is with great pleasure that we offer you our warmest thanks for your hard work and capable oversight of the 250th anniversary committee. Thanks to you and your fellow committee members, our town was treated to a weekend filled with family fun and great entertainment, satisfying food and drink, and a memorable fireworks display, just to name a few. There was something for everyone, from a world-class art exhibition to a Revolutionary War reenactment to a traditional summer fair. Best of all, the celebration brought the community together in an enjoyable way, something that we sorely needed after the trying events of Conway's other recent historic event in February of the tornado. Signed, three selectmen of Conway. I'll make a motion to approve the letter.
Oh, gladly second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I do want to say on the record, in front of the cameras, that we really, really appreciate what that committee did for us. They worked five consecutive hard years, hundreds and hundreds of hours to put this that together. And I, from what I saw, everything came off without a glitch, and it was
perfect.
Absolutely one of the one.
Even the weather.
And we had, I had
barely
several townspeople come to me and ask me if the committee would do it over again another time, and I said probably not. So, Okay, Melvin, thanks. All right. Next item. We want to go to meet with Dana and the.
Dana and Roy is out there somewhere, isn't he?
He was here. He had to run back to get his phone.
Oh.
So I don't know if he made it back yet.
Okay.
He's not back yet. Is this Roy?
Is that him?
That's Melvin.
Okay. We'll wait a couple minutes, okay? He'll be back in a couple minutes, Dana, I think. All right, next item, to discuss the formation of the Highway Garage Committee is the next item on the thing. I guess we need to officially start the committee back up again.
Yeah.
And I would request that you, myself personally, would request that you contact the original committee members.
Mm-hmm. I've done a little bit of that. I've done a little bit of that informally.
Was all three of the selectmen on that committee, really?
No. There wasn't a select board member, okay. Committee member, right.
Should there be or not be, or I don't know.
Maybe we can wait for John to come back before, you know, to discuss that particular part, but I will formally...
I would be interested in, seeing I pursued the getting it put on a warrant, I would be interested in working with them.
If
any of them will allow themselves to be reappointed.
Willing to, yeah.
I think it's a great venture that needs to be looked at again, and we need to look at also, as well as we know, the offer that Greg Rose passed by us a few weeks ago with offering his property to the town, for the barn and the stall shed stuff. Yeah. That needs to be looked at in that same package.
The landscape has changed.
The landscape has changed tremendously, so I think we need to look at all that in the future. So.
All right, well, this will certainly be on the agenda for some time to come. Yep. So.
I'll make a motion that we formally reform the town garage committee.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. And then you're going to start doing that.
You're going to start doing all wrong?
Yeah, I'll contact everybody formally.
Now, does that committee have a chair? Do you remember last time they did?
Well, it did. Ken was the chair. Okay. The new committee will be a new committee.
Oh, sure. New committee.
Yeah. Still no Roy?
Okay. Next item, a request from the Highway Department.
He's outside talking to Malcolm.
Oh, is he?
He's talking to Malcolm. Nick. All right. Maybe.
Do you want to talk about the Highway Department requesting regarding the shuttle letter here somewhere. Would you like me to read Ron's real letter?
Sure. Yeah. Sure.
To the town administrator, Tom Hutchison, from Ron Street, Highway Superintendent. Regards the 1990 International Fire Truck. That's the truck that they were just replaced with the new pumper just came in. I am writing to express my interest in the fire truck that was recently replaced by the fire department. We feel the benefits of this truck for the highway department outweigh the small amount of money received if sold. The highway department could utilize this truck for flushing pipe culverts, washing and maintaining the undersides of bridges, as a water supply for grading roadways, and a water supply for contractors. We have utilized the fire truck pumper occasionally for some of these jobs. I know they have that in the past. The piece of equipment would allow us to do these jobs more efficiently and save manpower, many man hours. Having a piece of equipment like this without having an impact on the town other departments and have concerns of losing it in the middle of a job due to a fire emergency would take a large burden off our department. That being said, if the town needs to utilize the fire truck for an emergency public safety, we would make it available. And that was signed by Ron Sweet. Dana, come on in a minute. We're going to ask you guys a question. You and Roy's on the committee too, right?
Yep.
Come on in, have a seat. This one pertains to you guys too. Our original plan was to have this fire truck put out for bid after the new owners replaced it and put up for sale. And Ron's requested to, instead of having it put up for sale, to turn it over to the highway department for his future use of all these different items we just talked about here. I guess, seeing you're the capital planning committee and you oversee a lot of the money issues, I'd like to hear your opinions on that too.
I would support that.
It's not worth that much, is it?
What do you think? What would we get for it?
I was thinking somewhere in the $10,000 range.
Yeah, perhaps. Probably no more than that.
I mean, you know in the past that they barely...
Most of them are going for around $5,000.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's a stretch.
That's a stretch. So, the only thing I'm going to ask that we not vote on this tonight, because I don't feel being the head of the fire department, I should vote on this. So I support this offer tremendously. I think it's a good idea. And I think that we should let's wait to put it on the agenda for next week for John and Bob to vote for.
Okay.
You okay?
Yeah.
Everybody? Great. All right. Next item, consider the use offer of a UCC. Oh, let's go with these guys first.
Yeah.
We do this?
Yeah.
We're going to move forward to the joint meeting with the Capital Improvements Planning Committee to consider the long-term financial plan of the town's Commonwealth Compact, Community Compact. Tom, would you like to head up that discussion?
Sure. Thank you for coming. This is the, I hope, the end of a long process that began about a year ago. We signed on to the Community Compact right up there in back of our Chair Pro Tem for a couple of items. One of them was IT best practices, and another was financial best practices. And the particular item we signed on for was creating a long-term financial plan for the town. The we've been working for a year with Joe Markarian, who's formerly a Department of Revenue person out in Western Mass, helping all the Western Mass towns with their finances. And he's now retired from that, but working part-time with the Franklin Regional Council of Governments to help towns with their community compact work. Came up with a draft plan, and it incorporated a whole lot of parts, including something on capital improvements planning. The Finance Committee met last week and decided to approve the plan. They particularly considered some of the hard financial targets in the plan. There's a section that's heavy on finance policy. And they went through and specifically approved each of those with one amendment. There was there's a kind of a standard idea that towns having a debt load of about 5% is looked on favorably by banks when you're borrowing. And it was generally thought that while that might be true with towns with more infrastructure, Conway being a very rural town, 3% was a much more reasonable kind of figure to work with.
So, and is that what we have now?
We have nothing now. We have no financial plan, no policies.
No, but the
so
debt.
We have zero debt. Uh-huh. Well, that's not quite true. We are starting to pay for the fire pumper. But we have very, very little debt.
Yeah.
And, of course, we have lots of projects in mind. We have the highway garage in mind. There's the idea of some renovations for town hall. There's a possible public safety complex in the future. So we will be joining the towns with a little bit more building needs, certainly, pretty soon. So, again, the Finance Committee has met and approved it with that one change, that one amendment. And the other major financial policy group in town is the Capital Improvements Planning Committee, of which I will mention in case not everyone knows that Bob Armstrong is a member of, as well as Roy and Dana. So we have a quorum of that group here tonight, and I would be very interested to hear your thoughts on the capital planning portion of that plan.
Okay. I Joe's way laid it out. Now, obviously, the town of Northboro is significantly larger than Conway, but following that general outline, I thought was great.
So that's something you can work with.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yes. Did you happen to talk to him about the 3%, 5% debt situation? Did you happen to mention that to Joe?
I've notified him of that by email. Yeah. This is the town's plan.
Yeah.
And his...
I was just curious if you had, like, yeah, that's probably great, or you need to go to 5%.
I can anticipate that part of his response would be, any figure is better than no figure.
That's true.
He's got 3% in that, right?
He's got 5%.
He had 5%, yeah.
Yeah, and that's a standard figure, but you know, the standard town is not a rural town in Massachusetts. I mean, it may be in terms of number, but not in terms of the, you know, what banks are used to dealing with you know.
Talking about towns that would have a fleet of police cruisers, more highway equipment than we do, maybe two ambulances instead of one.
They have water and sewer.
And water, yeah. And maybe even electric light.
Yeah, they could. So so this is something for us to work with. It's a living, breathing document. It is intended to be reviewed periodically and assessed as to how it's doing. And it's not something that... that is meant to bind the town, but to guide it, to give it some boundaries to say, okay, if we do this, we know we're going according to plan, and this plan is something which is financially responsible.
Now, would he write... Yeah, I looked at this, and the first thing that came to my mind is, oh my God, oh, we have to sit down and write this ourselves. I mean, this is a guide, I know, based on Northboro, but would he write it for us? Is that part of the deal? Or?
Oh, yes, and that's a separate piece. That was something that came, and I should have made this clear. I was a little jammed when I sent that out. Those are pieces that were from Alan Singer.
Mm-hmm.
The capital improvement plan is it includes a lot of things that are not that. It includes my annual budget.
Yes.
Document.
Mm-hmm.
It includes some definitions. It includes some charts and financial projections that we can use going forward as well. But there are those just few pages of financial policy that I had sent out. I think you got the full document earlier in a draft form.
Yep.
No, the one from Joe earlier.
Well, can I make a comment?
Yeah, please.
So really, this is the program. This is the plan. The plan is part of the program, as I understand it. Mm-hmm. Along the program has to do with how you communicate, how you disseminate the information. Again, Tom, you can correct me if I've got this correct or wrong.
I think you're right.
Okay. And I basically agree with Dana, but one thing did come to my mind, and that is, with the current FTE, full-time equivalent employee staffing level, is this completely doable, or is this going to require another town employee to manage them.
This, like Tom just said, is a, I would call it a guideline to follow. It's nothing set in stone.
Like the 3%?
Just a guideline to follow.
Well, the guy, yes, but it's pretty nice when you have these, you know, you have stuff like this here for every project, you know, this kind of thing. I mean, it's really nice.
I mean, who's going to do
it? It's nice when it's in one place. It's nice when it all flows through to a, you know, to a spreadsheet that for once we could have the entire town, including the school, under an umbrella. But it seems to me that this is a bit of work to get to that place.
So. Yes, it is. And again, that comes from the workshop that Alan Singer went to. That's additional information for you to stick in the black folder there as an example of a capital improvements plan from, as Dana pointed out, a much more complex town. What is in the long-term financial plan that Joe Markarian provided for us, and I believe a first draft was sent around, is much less than that. There are some financial projections that you'll be interested in as a finance committee member, because we'll be able to plug in various values and assumptions and see where we end up in 5, 10, 20 years. For capital improvements, he did include, based on what we'd already drawn up, you know, here's the vehicles and here's the replacement schedule and things like that. So that's all included, and I'm printing that out now in the back. That's the most advanced part of this. The basics of the policies were in the original draft.
Right. But so again, we have policies, we have a plan, and then we have a program. There's really three pieces we're looking at here. This maybe is nice to have kind of thing, the program.
Yeah.
The policies, in my mind, are essential, and a plan would be great. I mean, you know, we're talking a six-year plan, same as they, because when we, I mean, the closest we got to this, and I wasn't even on the committee, that was trying to establish, you know, a life, useful life of the highway equipment and this kind of thing. And so, I think it's all great.
But I think what we're voting on today are the policies.
Okay.
Right, I mean, well, that's what Joe Markarian gave us.
Are the policies in here?
No, they were in the document that I think Tom is reading.
I didn't even see that. No, I mean, I saw the policies that the Finance Committee voted on, these debt levels and et cetera.
Something that Tom had
some time ago. Yeah. Well, it sounds to me like the only thing you guys were presented was that 5%. The question that 5% area.
Well, it was 7% was the number that came out, and it's and I perhaps led the discussion questioning the number. It's like, what does it look like to have a 5% level of debt? Now, you say, well, instead of just buying stuff outright, you know, you finance it. But it does say in here, don't do it on stuff under $25,000. Pay cash for that stuff. Right. It does say, you know, he does say that in here. But I understand, because it's the only way that infrastructure apparently is going to get done. There's no tooth fairy that's going to bring us infrastructure.
But I thought you were asking who's going to make that plan.
Well, I was saying that.
And I don't know.
Is it doable given the current level of staffing, or do we have to allow
for? Do we look to Lisa to make that plan for us? You know, I don't know.
Well, she'd probably need at least another day or two per week.
That's right.
Probably.
Right.
So that has to be taken into consideration. And I think there's a... I mean, it took, you know, I think there's a digestion process that the citizens of the town are going to need to go through. Not every citizen goes here, they don't say, oh, hell, we have like no infrastructure. I said, oh, isn't this charming? Oh, isn't this great? I never want to see this change. So, and he did forget to mention one major thing that it may be confronting us, and that's bridges.
Yep. So, that's huge. He's backing away from that stuff.
Well, it seems like they're backing away from most stuff. Okay, so that's where it's coming from. So I was the one who pushed that number, saying maybe 3% is a point for the town. You know, 3% of roughly 5.5 million is, and that is that's debt. Total debt, am I right, Tom?
Is that about
$150,000? Yeah. No, it's debt service payments. So what does that $150,000 represent?
Oh, the amount of debt.
Every year. Yeah, and over time, you pay off some and new comes on, and that's a low number. That's the 3%. Kick it up to 5%.
Gotta believe that.
5% is roughly $5 million, roughly $250,000, right?
Right.
Yeah. When you think of what kind of debt service payments of $250,000 a year.
Well, it's gonna pay for a bridge maybe, or two. Right. You
know. It's really just
a million bucks for a bridge.
Yeah. But I'm kind of hoping that at some point we're going to see the state.
Well, that was my attitude as well, but nobody really wants to hear that.
That's the page, yeah, that single page is the policy that Joe included in his draft. And then the multi-page thing I thought I'd print out as well, because that's some of the additional work that he did that would lead toward that kind of program that you're looking at now. So,
yeah, I have no problem with the policy.
Yeah.
The things the real questions that he wanted discussion on were the definition of a capital improvement. As he says, a tangible asset or project with an estimated useful life of 5 years or more and a cost of $5,000 or more. Those are parameters that, you know,
we
can say yes, we can say no, we could make it $10,000, we could make it 7 years, you know, so that's something to think about as time goes by. This is his initial, he said, why don't you start with this and see what goes by, but that's why that's underlined, is that those are things that he thought the town might want to look at more closely. Is it really 5 years? Is it really $5,000 or more? This is the page of the policy from the draft. And here's something new, actually, that the multi-page thing was
Russ, come out to the table, buddy.
That Joe came up with that is some work that he did to start off, to start everybody off. So that's the policy that he's doing. And I was just saying that the underlined bits there are things for the, he's suggesting that as a place for the town to start off as a definition of what's a capital expense. But we might want something more. Sometimes it's $10,000 or 7 years, something like that. So it's something for the town to consider.
Nothing in
as
this,
it goes
this
forward.
Policies, however they were approved to start up, nothing in there says you can't change it.
Yeah, it is meant,
or have
it
to
is
follow
meant to
it.
Be
it's
flexible.
A working, it's a work in progress.
It is meant to be flexible, absolutely.
It's nothing hard stone, so just because we have printed this way, we got to abide by this.
Right.
Guideline.
If you don't abide by it, you'll know you're not abiding by it, and you're making that choice consciously rather than just slipping away into an area you might not want to go.
Roy had a good question for you, Tom, and where you were stepping up to do that. Brent, he wants to know who's going to manage this thing, or put this whole package together and keep up with all this information and dollar amounts and everything in here every year. Who's going to be doing that?
Yeah, there's two parts to that. One is the capital improvement part to it, and he started with those figures. That's the second, that's the multi-page handout you have there. The financial plan itself is financial projections, and those are things that I will be entering in the, you know, Article 2. Every year you add that in, you add in some information about borrowing and things like that, and that keeps a record of the town's finances up to date within this document.
So at what point do we terminate using him? After we approve all the whole package? He's pretty well done?
Yeah. He's just waiting for approval of this round. He'll come up with a final document, and that'll be what the town uses, and that's that. He'll say to the state, yes, the town of Conway, he will certify to the state that the town of Conway has adopted this plan. And again, the other parts to it are definitions, some internal financial policies that he just lifted that we already have, you know, reconciliation procedures and things like that between the treasurer and the accountant. So he took those policies. We already had all of those that we were supposed to. There's my annual budget that's also included in this document, and it will change year to year. Every year I'll put in the new one, and that will be part of this financial plan going on year to year, and it will change. So it does get updated annually. I do part of it. Capital improvements does part of it, and those are the moving parts.
Well, it starts just like now. It starts at the department level, right? I mean, so you know, so there's department heads have to give thought as to what they see coming up, maybe with the help of you or an administrator.
Ronnie's already done that.
But you do this
to some extent. I think you have too.
You do this every year.
Yeah.
You know, you got
to. Yeah, to look for it. If you're not looking for it, you're not doing your job.
Right. But the driver of the whole process is going to be the administrator, I would imagine, because you know you've got to pull it all together, just like
the rest of the administration.
Yeah.
Yes. Absolutely. So the buck stops with me.
So. Am I hearing this correct? That any one of your committee members really don't have any hang up or anything, any part of this that you think we need to change up front?
I don't think so.
I think it's okay.
Okay. You need a vote by us?
Yeah, a vote from the Capital Improvements Committee would be good. That's
and them four.
So you want to make a motion?
Motion to approve the capital improvement program policy as recommended by Joe
Markarian.
Yeah. Have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No opposition. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Now, can he vote as selectman?
Right. Yeah.
It's a crazy thing.
Yeah.
He's on the committee.
A member of the committee too.
He's on both.
Yeah. Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve. The same motion they just did, would the same way?
We don't vote on the capital improvement.
No,
you would vote on the
whole plan. The whole thing, yeah.
And again, with the finance committee already having approved their
report. They have that, right?
Yeah.
So they've approved it, and I'll make a motion that we approve it.
So I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
So that's what Joe
needs. Thank you.
To your point, didn't we have a
forward
somebody
forward.
Come up with your voting on the capital improvement items only if there was a tie, or was it me that didn't vote?
You're the one that said that. I don't know.
No, it wasn't me. It was somebody else who's here.
I can tell you who that was.
Oh, that was at one of our meetings. Was here.
You were here too. Yeah,
and it was with the wastewater committee.
Yeah, who brought that up though?
Mr. Strugowski.
Was it Joe?
Oh, it was Joe.
That?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's.
And I guess what? I wasn't supposed to vote unless it was a tie or was
no,
it?
No, that is your prerogative. You are free to do as you will. I think he had some idea
Somebody
back from
that,
when
right?
he was chair, but you can absolutely vote on anything you want. You're a full member of the committee.
Okay. So now we know.
Sign off.
I think Joe saw which way the vote needed to go.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Anything else?
Yeah, thank you. Good then. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
You guys come in and spend your time on it.
Thank you.
And look forward to next year.
Yeah. I'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
Oops, I'm sorry. I'm flying back in here.
Okay. Before we move into the UCC church thing, we have a couple more, because I don't see a list here anywhere. Couple more approvals for, I can read this right, it says, these were voted 6th June 12th meeting, but had incorrect term ending dates.
Those just need to be signed. John can sign them.
Those shouldn't have been in the yellow folder. Okay, so those are not to be signed as part of this evening's
by the
business.
Chairman, so that he can take care of all that, right?
He can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, we should keep those separate from the business
of the
evening.
Someone from the church is going to come here. Do we know what time?
No, someone from the church is not here. This is for the select board. Okay.
Okay, let me open it.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Next item on the agenda is to consider an informal offer of the United Congregational Church to pay back $100,000 from the CPA appropriation. Tom?
We heard from our town council that he had heard from the lawyer for the church that they were considering two options. One of the options was just paying back the $100,000. The other option had to do with proposing a land swap, giving us land instead of money, because the church has land. Both town council and I agreed that is not an appropriate thing for the town to get involved in.
It's kind of risky,
isn't it? It's very, it might not even be legal in procurement law. So we agreed on that, and he felt comfortable going back to the UCC lawyer to say that. Now, that said, that was an informal communication from the lawyer. You know, he wanted the select board to, again, have the opportunity to say, would this be a satisfactory resolution for the town? And he and I both agree that this would be the cleanest way to go forward. Now, we haven't received a formal offer from them yet. But I think they're waiting to hear whether or not the town, this is something that the town would be desirous of doing. And it certainly is my recommendation and his that it's the cleanest.
So would we
forward.
Take this to a special town meeting?
No,
it's already part of the agreement that we signed with them.
Okay. And the agreement is pretty clear the way it was worded, that any major destruction to the buildings or anything like that, the first thing has to be done is the $100,000 has to be paid back to the community.
That's right.
And that's okay. The historical commission.
I think that we should uphold that. They uphold it when they signed it.
It's a signed agreement that we have in when we gave them the money. There was a contingency in there in case in this case, which you know back then you would have thought, well, that'll never happen.
Right.
But it did happen. The
so
church
you
was
need a motion
destroyed.
From us?
Well, I think right now, just the, you know, you'd like to pursue this option or something.
I'll make a motion that we pursue the option of the United Congregational Church, paying back the $100,000 to the town is the most cleanest move to do at this present time, and then they can move forward with the church whatever way they want after.
So I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. Items not anticipated 48 hours in advance of the meeting. Do we have anything?
Nothing except Malcolm, but he was under citizens' concerns.
Okay.
Good.
Town administrator update.
Good Lord. I have one of those, don't I? What is this? In committee news, John Heffernan indicated that he might be stepping down from his membership on Parks, Recreation, and Trails. He has trained a couple of others on baseball logistics and will be working with the committee to ensure smooth operations. He's he's certainly working, he's continuing to work now, but he's definitely thinking about stepping down after this season. In what will be excellent news for several of our residents, several of whom have called me, the tennis net is now up.
Okay.
There was some concern that it needed work before being put up. I have been assured that it is functional, although we may need a replacement soon. It's not in perfect condition.
Yeah. Now, is that something that has to be budgeted in advance?
Yeah, that should be, and you know, that's, maybe it'll get a little worse before it gets better because it's not in the FY18 budget.
It should probably be
in the FY19 budget.
Maybe we should somehow consider putting him right there for the 19 budget.
Yes.
Not to forget this.
That will be a clear message to the Parks and Rec Committee. If they haven't already put it down. The Finance Committee met and granted two reserve fund transfer requests, one for employee benefits, and there is a correction to my last report, only health insurance was over budget in employee benefits, and one reserve fund transfer request for the town match for the ADA self-evaluation and transition plan grant. I'd mentioned this, both of those to you before, but they both took Finance Committee action. That is, that is now complete.
So do we have money budgeted for that match? Where does that?
It came from the reserve fund. The Finance Committee voted to transfer the money.
They did, okay, good.
Yeah. In other Finance Committee news, Jim Bosman is considering resigning from the committee.
Oh.
If you know of anyone who might be interested, please let him, or the moderator, or me, know. I've been going back and forth with the Historic Commission, the Community Preservation Committee, and Town Council about the most appropriate form of the agreement with the schoolhouse for their roof repair. I believe we're close to a final resolution, and I'm hoping we have a document for you to sign in July. That may be optimistic, but I hope.
I would recommend that if we do have this signing for the document in July, that we get it enough in advance that we can digest it before we come to the vote.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I believe that our interests will best be served by using the template provided by the Mass Historical Commission on their website. And I did draw up a version of that, which replaces Nantucket with Conway.
So this is the tiny little schoolhouse right next to the grammar school?
No, that's the old grammar school.
This is
the old grammar school. Oh,
yes,
okay.
On Schoolhouse Road.
Okay.
Remember how they voted to fund their roof,
yep,
right?
Yep, we did. Yeah.
Regarding a June 12th item, remember... the chair of the Conservation Commission was in.
I wasn't here then.
He mentioned that they'd been having trouble getting quorum, and that while he was willing to serve another 3-year term.
Jack Gates, were you not here that day?
No, I was not. No, but I did read your notes.
Yeah.
And he wanted to know a bit more about the background of the committee, and I did ascertain that. The Conservation Commission started with 3 members in 1986, but town meeting raised that to 5 in 1988. I think I have those dates right. I can check on them if you like. So it would take a town meeting vote to change the number.
This crippling them from doing their business the way it is, though?
Not yet, but it's very close.
Right?
Yeah. It's a 5-member commission now.
So you need 3 to...
There are only 4 on it. And one of them is not able to participate.
So they really need a full board before they go majority of the vote.
So all of them have to show up all the time.
Yeah.
Right. In department news, on June 13th, I delivered testimony for the Massachusetts Municipal Management Association supporting civic education. The Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, DESE, has been in the process of revising their curriculum framework for history and the social sciences, and many groups are advocating for a more prominent civic education component. Of course, the interests of the municipal managers is in local government education.
I agree. That's been lacking.
A tornado update. The Department of Conservation and Recreation approved our forest cutting plan last Monday, June 19th. This is by the grammar school.
Okay.
Natural Heritage did not require any modifications. We will now flag the town land, notify the abutter, and get bids for removing the damaged wood. Piece of information, any funds expended in fiscal year 2017, including all the overtime worked right after their tornado, will be funded directly by FY 2018 taxes. It'll go directly onto the tax rate. Any work done in fiscal year 2018 will be funded directly by 2019 taxes. This is the emergency account that was set.
So we don't have an overrun on any budgets.
Yeah, since it was an emergency account, it goes directly onto the tax rate. I am working on the dry well danger issue with Jim Hawkins at the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. Once we get the mailing address of the property owners, he will send them a letter noting that there is a threat to life and safety that they are obliged to address.
So this came from that incident recently with the dog?
Yeah.
You know the people's name? And
yeah. Just need to confirm the mailing address.
And do we believe there's other wells like that in town?
No, here you can get the mailing addresses from Cecilia's.
No idea. Yeah, I thought I was going to be able to get it from Jan today,
Jan, but
she was all jammed up with all those warrants, especially the payroll warrant. And finally, there will be an Americans with Disabilities Act grant. Remember, we got that grant from the Mass Office on Disability for a self-evaluation and a transition plan, a meeting on Thursday morning. Tom McCarthy and Rusty Blossom are involved, as well as Ron as building maintenance manager.
Good.
So that's how that's moving forward, and that's my report. There seemed to be some sort of celebration over the last 2 weeks that I also did a little bit of work on, but not as much as most other people, so I didn't put that in.
Trying times to come in, but it all came off wonderful.
Yeah.
Everybody needs to be thanked for that. Okay.
You're not putting in your second place beard?
Well, that was a length. I did get best old school.
Yes, you did. Best, yes.
Yes.
Okay, any concerns of the selectmen?
Nope.
I can't think of any either. I probably remembered after it. Okay. Mail. Okay. We have a letter complaint of a property damage letter from the police chief.
Yeah, that's a copy to the select board.
Copy to the select board.
So nothing.
I think we need to discuss it all. I reviewed it.
Bob, I read it. You know, it's basically asking the chief to do an investigation.
Yeah. I just mentioned that was in the mail. That's an ongoing investigation, I guess. So. Okay. And the next item is Council of Governments. Let's see what this says. From the building commissioner.
Oh, yes.
This is from head of the Greenfield Savings Bank.
Was denied a request for a sign because it did not meet Conway's sign. Regulations, okay. And they've been advised to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals if they would like to appeal that.
For a waiver?
Yeah.
Yeah, they exceeded the size of it from towns has 15 square foot maximum length size sign. They're asking for 28 square foot.
Wow.
So that's in the works,
yeah.
Right? Okay. Next one, this is another Malcolm Course one. What is this one? Oh, two Malcolm Course. As you know, Wednesday, January 4th, 2012, the Historical Commission which you were a member of, formally voted to appoint you to the Conway Community Preservation Committee, which represented the Historical Commission. Subsequently, effective July 1st, 2004, you renewed your application. What's this all about, Tom?
It's a copy to the select board of Malcolm's appointment to the CPC from the Historic Commission. The Historic Commission gets to appoint a member to the Community Preservation Committee, so that's notifying the select board that he is...
Through July 1st.
He has been appointed.
Okay. Have we done that appointment yet?
No, that's an appointment from the Historic Commission to the CPC. They get a representative.
So just making us aware of that, okay.
Yeah.
I get it. And the last one is to John O'Rourke. What is this one about, Tom? New England Power Company and the Massachusetts Electric Company.
Oh.
It's providing a 30-day notification of upcoming sideline vegetation management activities in your community.
They're going to be spraying.
So that's their normal yearly letter they send out to let you know that they're going to be doing
along the
spraying.
Along the lines.
High tension wires.
They'll be clearing the lines, in case anyone sees anyone out there, that's what they're doing.
I see they did cover for you. The sideline will work beginning from now to March 31st of 2018. Mm-hmm. Okay. They're just making you aware that that's what they're going to do. Okay. Mm-hmm. Any announcements anybody's got?
No.
Okay, the next meeting is scheduled for Monday, July 10th, 2017, here at the town office at 6 p.m. Do we need anything to do with
I don't think we need either of those.
Okay, I've been seeing nothing else on the agenda. I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.